computer. Now we are going to look at functional requirement documentation. We'll look at non-functional requirement. We'll also look at data model diagram. So this kind of will give you an idea of how it is done. So let me share again. See, you will see a lot of details. So there's a documentation detail, there's versioning. This is an old school way of writing, but if you're getting into functional requirement documentation, be aware this is all part of the requirement. Okay, so how does it start? So you'll see that the functional requirement is basically talking about the different functionalities explained in detail. You always start with background, purpose, intended audience, references, document. Then you will, so this is another style of writing document. So what is a functional requirement document? It's a BRD plus technical aspects involved or included into the BRD becomes a functional spec. A business functional spec will have business requirement documentation. It has user stories, use cases. It could have process maps. It can have wireframes. Along with it, it will talk about data model architecture. It will talk about business rules or validations. It will talk about risks and assumptions. Along with this, it will also have a lot of data flow diagrams. That's your functional requirement. A functional requirement documentation is usually consumed by IT teams or developers. A business requirement document is consumed mostly by business users. Hence, there's a lot of technical flavor. There's a lot of specific functional related information that you are going to include in the functional requirement document. FRD, functional requirement documentation, SRS, system requirement specification are different variations of documentation, which is having a high level of technical flavor and is used mostly by internal teams to build software. A business requirement documentation is a business-like document written in business language for the business users. Let's quickly go through this. So I'm going to walk you through this so you will have an understanding of how this piece is done. Are you able to see my screen? What documentation?
Yes.
Okay, cool. Cool. So you see, earlier we used to have what is called a requirement ID, we used to have some title, we used to have scope, we used to have functional requirement. Now again, you have a business requirement, you can have a functional requirement. That's because each business requirement can have multiple subsets. You know, this is an old school way of writing. You need to know this, have a 360 degree view of things, because you can work in any organization. And, you know, Agile has made life a lot easier, but it's good to know this thing. That is why I'm going to quickly walk through all this information. So you see, basically it's capturing same information, but what happens is this becomes very mundane. Another advantage of functional requirement is they will capture all the fields in a particular form, for example, or all the fields in a particular database table. But what it's not doing justice is, instead of putting it like this, I could rather add a wireframe to the documentation instead of, you know, mentioning these fields separately. That's a small change. So keep it as visual as possible. It's a lot more. Now these 3-4 pages could be, you know, easily, finished in 2 kind of pages. You don't need so much of information. It has a requirement ID. It has title. So this is the functional requirement documentation for you. I will show where is the variation. So it's a lot more easier. So you see, where is the data part coming in? Is there a data part at all? So you see, they have included a data dictionary, glossary, or abbreviation list in the appendix. You can choose to put it in the appendix as well. So this is old school way of writing functional requirements. I feel there's some amount of technical architecture and visual representation that's missing this kind of functional requirement documentation. What is missing is let's look at non-functional requirement. A non-functional requirement, we'll talk about, so who usually captures non-functional requirements? Non-functional requirements are usually captured by a tech lead because it has a lot of technical flavor to it. But sometimes you work in a heavy, a technical oriented application or teams, so you also have to have an understanding of how to write non-functional requirements, or at least have a general idea of how to write this. What is non-functional requirement all about? It will capture information like, what is the user volumes? How many users are going to use the application? How many users are going to have, on an average, what is the maximum load that the application take in one go? For example, if you're a Amazon.com or let's say Netflix, on Sundays, your user volume will actually go up versus on other days. Or for example, if it's a B2B application, how many people will use this application in one go? Okay. If it's a claims process system, how many people can at most use this application? So that's user volume and metrics. Let me quickly get there and explain this. You're talking about 500,000 active users, 2,000 simultaneous active sessions. This is your user volume. This is you will capture as non-functional. You're also talking about data volumes. You'll talk about 500,000 new transactions per day. 6 months history needs to be maintained. 30 months history needs to be available as online, offline reports. These are certain NFRs. This will determine whether I need to, I will determine in my infrastructure capacities, the kind of technologies I can use, kind of technology stack I can use. All this, you know, becomes important. You will also see that users can be classified into internal and external users. Okay, so they were calling out who are internal users, who are external users. What is the language being used? What are the interfaces? This is very important. Sometimes you don't support some old versions of Internet Explorer. So very important to call out all the interfaces that will be involved here. You have Internet Explorer, Safari, Mozilla, Chrome, etc. Then you're talking about availability. What is the availability? You need 365, 24/7. There will be a downtime of 2 hours and whatnot. Okay. So sometimes this even can get into a contract, but it is necessary to capture availability. Usability, again, usability will be based on certain UI standards. Scalability, you'll see that all components that are part of the ABC company, so I changed this to ABC company online solution, must be scalable. Scalable means today we are having 5,000 users. Tomorrow, if my business grows, can this application support 1,000 more users? Is it designed in such a way that it can scale? That is scalability for you. So a planned growth target of 5% per annum in the user. Extensibility. Extensibility talks about security. It talks about whether the web services can be consumed by other modules that are necessary along with AAA tokens. Okay. So whether the framework architecture guidelines should expose, basically extensibility is how flexible, how extensible is the architecture. Performance and SLAs are basically your service level agreements. How quickly should I respond? How quickly should a page load time, no target response time. If I request for a report or if I request for search results, if I want to download certain reports, what is the amount of time it should take to download? You see certain applications will be slow. Certain applications will be really quick. This requires non-functional requirements. So these are certain things you can capture as part of FRD, or you can create a separate document as well. Testability, tools, sometimes it's also, sometimes you call out the tech stack, not necessary, but it's good to have. Sometimes you also need to have recoverability process. This is something called as disaster recovery process. So this is a separate document, separate area, wherein if let's say you are having servers at multiple locations in the world, some places say you'll have failover servers in Singapore, some in US. If US servers fail, the failover servers will take over in Singapore. What is your data disaster recovery process, etc., that needs to be captured. Okay, then you're talking about security. What kind of data encryption? What kind of standards? All that must be called out in security. Authentication and authorization. Are you going to have single sign-on? Are you going to have multi sign-on, multiple step sign-in? Well, will you have other kind of sign-in standards? So there is huge level of access and identity and access related requirements that can be captured. So that is a totally different area. You should delve a little deeper. If you are having single sign-on, what are the different challenges that needs to be captured here? Encryption related, that also needs to come in here. Okay. So yeah, so these are some of the things that needs to go into a non-functional requirement. I have one more document on non-functional requirement, slightly the same flavor. What's non-functional requirement guide? It talks about reliability, operability, security, compatibility, maintenance. It's like, building your house, right? Let's say you buy a plot, you want to build a house. They will ask you questions like, how many people are going to stay? How many rooms do you want? What kind of material should we use? What kind of lighting? What is the investment required? So all this is basically the same thing. When you are actually constructing a software, you need to look at the brick and mortar part of it. You need to look at the civil engineering part of it. This is what it's all about. Your functional suitability, reliability, etc. So very important to understand this. I'm calling out functional stability, reliability, performance, efficiency, security, compatibility, maintainability, transferability, performance efficiency. I need to call time, behavior, resource utilization, performance efficiency. I will share this documentation. It will be useful for you. So it's a complete guide on non-functional requirements. Very, very useful to consume. As far as possible, make this very visual. So your functional requirements can have non-functional requirements also included, or you can create a separate document. Okay, so this is one thing. Then now let's look at data model. Some amount of data model documentation template is basically you're capturing data definition, which talks about what is the data all about, what is data modeling and architecture policies and standards. You need to get into this. You are capturing what is the purpose of capturing this data, who is the owner, how are you going to collect this, what are the quality requirements for the data, related to data, what is availability, completeness, consistency, precision, currency, uniqueness, confidentiality. Now, even I am not an expert in this area, especially trying to understand what is a precision, consistency, but there are certain metrics. I'm only trying to expose you to this so you know there is something like this existing. Okay, so data modeling formats are there. Need to know field length, encoding. There were times when we had to define field lengths, especially when you're doing data migration. You need to call out the different tables, different fields. What is the field length? What kind of for data format, field format that should exist? All this, right? So nothing much. The additional value that I can add here, the data model documentation. Something else. We looked at this non-functional requirement. We looked at user use case template. Yes, we looked at all these things. Now let's quickly get into some of the requirement management softwares. Okay, so here are some of the other documentation. We have high level design. These are architecture documentation. We have data migration strategy documentation. You can delve into a little bit of data migration strategy documentation, but yeah, It's good to know, but you are mostly as a business analyst, you get exposed to requirement standards. You know, so like we spoke about risk earlier, right? What is the kind of risks involved? Imagine in data migration, or I told you there are risk, lot of risk related to data dependencies. Here you're calling about availability of resources, data migration scope, limited or no documentation, data ownership, target system schema not well defined, execution window is not clear, data cleansing and may destabilize legacy systems, potential data gaps, some amount of risks that are involved. So you see, these are data migration flow diagram, which tells you how the data migration is planned. Here you see this is an overview of data migration strategy. They're explaining how this will be done. So there is data migration requirements. Here you will get involved as a BA. Wherever there's requirements, wherever they're talking a little bit about strategy, wherever there's requirements, requirement analysis piece is where you get involved. So anything requirement, you are there. Anything testing, you may get involved. So data migration planning is pretty detailed. Data cleansing, data modification, extraction and loading, all this is part of this data migration strategy documentation. Now, I'll show you a couple of softwares which you can use for requirement, gathering. Heard of this tool called Jira. Jira is a very requirement management software. It's an Atlassian product. Atlassian is the company. I think I have a login. One moment. I'm just logging in. Okay, so here I have logged into the system. This is Jira software for requirements. What you need to understand is there is a roadmap. This roadmap is basically like your project management tool where you're using your Gantt charts. A roadmap is telling you how often do we have to deliver something. So there are key milestones that are defined here. This is usually managed by a Scrum Master or a project manager. Okay, indicating what are the different modules, different features that need to be delivered in different timelines. As a business analyst, you know then how to work backwards to achieve this and complete this in time. Also remember, there is something called a sprint process. A sprint process in an agile is where you do 2 weeks of development, design development, and finally you deliver the feature. Okay, design development, etc. may take 3-4 days, but overall you get about 10 days of actual work that can be done. And out of that, 1 day actually goes in, all your you know, support activities, etc., some meetings, etc. So roughly you get about 8 to 9 days of good, you know, time to build that piece of feature. Okay, so it's usually 15 days. So what is important for you as a business analyst to remember is there is a backlog. Backlog is nothing but a list of all the requirements that you have created. So every time I need to run a sprint for 2 weeks, I pull requirements from here and then create that piece of software. A technical architect will work with you in order to decide which stories need to be picked up. Why technical architect? Because there could be a lot of dependencies. Also, there is a dashboard which actually tells you how the work is being done. Okay, here it will tell you how many are issues that you need to handle, how many are in progress, how many are get done. Let's quickly look at how to create a story here. Now, this is a project I had previously created. So you can start by creating a project. But for a business analyst, all this is readily set up. So you will see that I have to select a user story as user issue type as story. It could have task, bug, epics, or it could have certain other categories also. For convenience sake, I'm going to take story. Here is where I need to enter the summary, what exactly that user story is all about. I enter that information. And yesterday, if you remember, I mentioned as a user, I want to so that I want to basically, I want to perform a certain action for a certain outcome. So this is what I'm going to write. I have an option to attach supporting documentation, wireframes, process maps. I can link this to other user stories. Okay. And then after I create this, so you see there's a unique identifier already created. This is a system generated. So there is no need for you to do anything else. Like create your own unique identifier. Add a child issue. Now this could be an epic or it could be a story with multiple tasks within it. You know, add a field, add a button, remove this, add a dropdown, send a notification, add an email format. All this could be part of this particular feature. Therefore, you could add child stories. You could link this to other things. Also, you can assign this to someone within your team. Now I could assign this to, let's say, with somebody within my team. When I do this, they automatically get notified. Okay, so this is the beauty. So automatically they get notified. You can also add your manager. You can add watchers. I can add my manager also to this, or I can add other team members who are working on this particular ticket or would be interested. So anytime there is an update, automatically these members get notified. How convenient is this? So a lot of things have been automated, so everything can be easily tracked. So you will see that there is an history being generated every time you create something or add something to the story. This is called, you know, basically this is your audit history. It tells you who has edited, what have they done. And sometimes you can also add a lot of comments here. Every time I make an update, I could just add a comment to this requirement. So this is how convenient it is. So at minimum, you should know how to create a user story and link this to different stories, add supporting documentation. This is bare minimum that you can do as a business analyst. So this is for Jira software. Now there is another requirement software called Azure DevOps. This is a Microsoft product. Okay, this is also called TFS. Yeah, it's called TFS. It's a foundational server. Let me tell you what it is. TFS. It's a Microsoft product. What does this mean? It's a foundational server, but team foundational server. Okay. It's also called as Azure DevOps. Under Azure DevOps, you have this requirement piece. Very similar to how Jira works. You'll have a dashboard, you will have wiki, you will have summary, you will have same dashboards, you will have pipeline. The interesting part is a lot of your code, etc., can be directly linked to this. Okay, your GitLab, etc., can be directly connected. So a developer can know what stories are linked to this particular code and so on. And you can also automate your deployments. CI/CD also can be automated directly. So it's a one-stop shop for putting your requirements and ensuring it is directly implemented. From requirements to implementation, automated from here. So again, let me go to board. You're looking at sprints, you're looking at queries. I can add a new work item. So you see, certain terminologies are different, but if you see the process and working on these requirements are roughly the same. I create a new work item, whether it's an issue. So let's do this. So this is the backlog. So let's say, I clicked on test. Test is my user story. I have issue 7. This is called as issues. What? See, this is highly customizable. You can convert this issue into a story and so on. Okay, you can assign this to someone. Because I have a Microsoft product with my company, I'm able to do this and, you know, set this up. But again, this is same. I have to write the story, right? I'm going to write the user story here. Also, I can assign story points. So remember, in Jira and here also, you can assign story points. Story points is nothing but how much of effort is needed. How heavy is this functionality? This can be done by developers or tech leads. They will assign story points to this. Okay. So this is, then you can also discuss, they will discuss with you on how to do this. So then you are also saying follow. Okay. And let's say you want to follow this. So then this gets allocated to, let's say, one of the users. This is in the to-do. Now I can make this doing. That is, I'm working on this or done. So I can change the status. So this way, this is the bare minimum thing that you can do. You can link it. You can add attachments, right? So these are certain things you can do as a BA. So if you know this as bare minimum, your life becomes a lot more easier. Dragging and dropping which user stories must go into the next sprint, etc. So you see, you have a sprint here. There's a burn down chart. Okay, I can create a new sprint. I can add new stories. I can set up a start date and end date and start tracking it. So these are all examples of using a requirement management software. It has made life so much easier, so much simpler. But what it does is you have to create tons of user stories, link it, and you should know how the flow happens. Until and unless you don't know the larger picture in terms of process map, wireframe, and having created some basic documentation yourself, you know, to visually picturize how the entire different functionalities should flow, and you have features and sub features, how that becomes stories and scenarios, and how it should all be interconnected inside the requirement management software. You still need to step out of the requirement management software to have that visualization. A lot of whiteboarding, a lot of, you know, creating that in PPT or in Word document format gives you a lot of confidence and control on how you can link this in the requirement management software. So you should be open to all these activities. So TFS, Azure DevOps, you have Jira, then you have Rally software. Rally software is another very popular, requirement management tool. But if you want to get your hands dirty, I would say take the Jira trial version. Jira trial version is very limited in functionalities, but it is enough for you to get a hands-on on how it has to be done. And surprisingly, very interestingly, it has a lot of videos, watch a lot of videos on how to use this particular software. You see, you're all set to use this software directly with very little understanding on how to, you know, you do a lot of admin settings. So there are a lot of admin settings which helps you allocate or assign this ticket to your business users or customers or users. They will take a look, they will add some comments, etc. They will also validate these requirements. It's a great way to involve your customers and get validation as and when you're working on this. So that involves a lot of admin settings, admin permissions, etc. Okay. So any questions for me so far? Anything that you want to ask? Because I've been talking continuously. I know interaction is very little possible because it's highly intensive. When we get to the next topic, I will give you opportunity to do it hands-on. I will ask you to register. Next time when you're there, I will make you register on the spot on certain freewares. On those freewares, you can start simultaneously working parallelly with me and also do screen sharing to show what you have been able to develop. Okay, so this one is a little heavy, intensive, but there is no other go. This will give you a good understanding of what are the different kind of documentation that's possible as a business analyst. And what are the kind of applications or tools that you can use? Jira is something you should try out. Very good. It's a freeware, so it will help you manage anything. Okay, so that is another thing. You could also use Trello. Trello.com is one thing. I don't know if they have a free license. Yeah, so they sign up for free. You can use Trello also to do this kind of, you know, maybe it doesn't have all the requirement functionality, but it can be used. Let's say you're a domain, you're coming from a business background, you still want to use for collaboration, use a Trello board. A Trello board will help you. If I'm logged in, I don't want to use my Dell login because it'll have some proprietary information. But Trello board is also a great way to kind of, you know, understand the whole thing. That's pretty much what I had to share for today. Not sure why it's not showing up. So today my idea was to cover use case, BRD, talk a little bit about functional requirement. The software requirement specification also will involve, you know, a lot of your data model, data extraction, data migration strategy. It will also involve a lot of, you know, your architecture diagram. So that kind of information. A functional requirement is a combination of BRD and some sort of technical information that we spoke of. Use cases we covered. Either you do user stories or use cases. Use cases are roughly like epics. BRD we discussed, very important document. So we have done a good amount of work in the requirement space for the last 2 days, Saturday and Sunday. So I hope when you watch this video again, you have any questions, you please come back to me. More than happy to help you out. Next weekend, a lot more fun. You have more hands-on. You'll enjoy it a lot more because you're also doing it parallelly. You will also have access to some freewares. So we'll do process mapping. We'll also do wireframing. I think we will spend a lot of time doing this. When we do a lot of back and forth, I'm sure it may even spill over to the next day, which is day 6. So let's see how we need to adjust certain things. But next week also will be a lot of fun. So thanks for being on the call. That's pretty much what I wanted to cover today. Let's quickly look at what questions we have. Okay, please share as it may be useful. Okay. Sure. Any questions before I close? I see there are no questions, so I'm going to stop share. I'm going to stop the recording.